Hello and welcome for today's webinar. My name is Carmen Panacopoulos, and I will be your WebEx producer facilitator for this session. I will be in the background answering any WebEx technical questions, as well as my colleague, Judy May. During the presentation, all participants will remain in listening mode. And as a reminder, this event is being recorded for rebroadcast. We will be holding a Q&A at the conclusion of today's presentation. We received questions in advance, and we will be answering those questions during the Q&A. With that, we invite you to sit back, relax, and enjoy today's presentation. I would now like to introduce your first speaker for today, Prabal Chakrabarty. The floor is yours, Prabal.
Thanks, Carmen, and welcome, everyone. I'm Prabal Chakrabarty. I'm Executive Vice President for Regional and Community Outreach at the Boston Fed. I'm also the Community Affairs Officer, which means that I'm responsible for community outreach around the CRA and Community Reinvestment Act. So I don't want to take a lot of time in terms of the introduction, but just because you already know how important Community Reinvestment Act is to our country and the low and moderate income people, that's why you're here on this call. That's probably why so many of you provided comments that we've incorporated and used from stakeholders as the Federal Reserve has crafted this proposed rule. So what I really want to just focus on is why, you know, the purpose of this session, which is to have the Fed and Fed speakers present their proposal to you, this new advance notice of proposed rulemaking, and to encourage you to provide comments or further comments if you have. Be assured that many of the comments that you've made have found their way into this ANPR, and if you haven't sent comments, what we do appreciate, and Carmen will have a chance to speak about this later, is specific comments. They're the most valuable for us to make this act the best it can be. Why are we doing this? Well, I think we want to make sure we get CRA right, of course. But the other aspect to think about is we don't do this very often. CRA is not revised. I think the last revision has been a couple of decades now in terms of this major of a revision. And so it's really critically important that we get this right. This is also a time in our country with a renewed focus on racial justice and undergoing the COVID pandemic. This is a particularly important time to think about what kind of CRA we have for the economy that's going to emerge out of all of these changes and these new calls for justice. And obviously CRA has an important history there, but it also hasn't responded as well to changes in technology as it needed to. And so this is really the right time to be reforming CRA if you think about the future of banking. So that's my pitch to all of you to provide comments and to provide specific comments. But really, even if you don't provide comments, to really understand this proposed rule and the kinds of implications it has for the banking sector, and most importantly, for the communities that are the goal of improving economic conditions for low and moderate income communities, which is the goal of this act. So with that, I'm going to pass it back to Carmen, and we'll hear from other presenters from the Fed, including Andy Alzawi, about the rule itself. So take it back, Carmen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Prabal. And again, the presenters today are Andy Alzawi, Matt Holt, Brian Clark, and I will be facilitating some of the questions in the end. So, Andy, why don't I pass it on to you?
Thanks so much, Carmen. Good morning, everyone. Again, I am Andy Alzawi, and I am the officer that's in charge of consumer supervision here at the Federal Reserve Bank of Boston. And that responsibility, of course, includes oversight of the Community Reinvestment Act. And I just want to echo Prabal's comments. You know, I think one of the main reasons we're here today is we just really want to try to get this right at the Federal Reserve. This isn't something that happens very often, and there have been a significant amount of changes in the landscape, both for consumers and the banking industry. And CRA, as good as it is and as good as the construction was 25 years ago, isn't really aging too well in terms of some of those changes. So we really want to make sure we provide opportunities like today's webinar just to make sure we get the message out. And you know, I'm joking around, this is the get out and vote speech. You know, this is the presentation for you to take a look at the ANPR and really, if there's any concerns or comments, to get those back to the Federal Reserve so we can incorporate that into the final rule. And I'm going to be joined, as Carmen said today, by Matt Holt. And Matt Holt is one of our senior examiners here at the Boston Fed and is a subject matter expert in CRA. So he'll be taking us through the second half of the slide deck this morning. So as we moved on to the slide two here, I think Carmen did. Yep. I'm going to start with a brief discussion of the CRA modernization objectives that guided us as we are drafting the ANPR. And then we'll walk through some of the key proposals in the ANPR, which are related to assessment areas, the evaluation framework, including the retail test and the community development test, qualifying activities and geographies, ratings, data collection, and provisions impacting rural communities. The ANPR was informed by extensive and robust outreach, including feedback from industry and community leaders, as well as ideas from the three banking agencies and community development and supervision staff across the Federal Reserve System. Again, I also want to encourage everyone to review the ANPR over the course of the next few weeks and to note the areas where we are seeking feedback. Matt and I will mention a few of these as we go today, but there are many questions throughout the document, and we would certainly look forward to hearing your thoughts. We'll also review the process for submitting comments at the close of this presentation. So let's see, slide three. Yep, we're in slide three. Thanks, Carmen. So the board published the advance notice proposed rulemaking on September 21st. And as you've heard, you'll see this reference to as an ANPR. You'll also hear us refer to the Board of Governors in Washington simply as the board throughout this presentation. Where we are right now, this is the very start of a rulemaking process, and it is a way for the board to get feedback on a proposed framework for CRA modernization before getting to the point of proposing a new regulatory text. So this is an advance notice of proposed rulemaking. In addition to the ANPR itself, there are a number of materials on the Federal Reserve's website about the ANPR, and there are some links to those materials here. And as you can see from this slide, there is a long 120-day comment period, and the comment deadline for the ANPR is on February 16th, 2021. We'll talk in a little more detail about the Fed's objectives for CRA modernization in the next few slides. So as you can see here in slide four, our objectives with CRA modernization fall into several broad categories. First, as you can see on the slide, we are focused on strengthening CRA to better meet its statutory purposes. As Governor Brainard has said in recent remarks, CRA is more important today than ever before, particularly in light of the COVID-19 pandemic and the national discussion around racial injustice. CRA was originally enacted in 1977 to address redlining, and it remains an important tool to address income inequality. The CRA statute directed the relevant federal financial supervisory agencies to encourage the banks they supervise to safely and soundly meet the credit needs of the communities they serve, including the banking needs of low and moderate income, or LMI, neighborhoods, and evaluating their record of doing so. Research has shown that the CRA has had positive impacts on financial inclusion and access to capital and financial services. And the law encourages banks to be important partners in broader efforts to revitalize communities across the country. However, even with the implementation of the CRA and other complementary laws, the lasting impact of discriminatory lending and inequalities to access of credit clearly remains evident today. As a result, the ANPR includes proposals to address inequalities in credit access, banking needs for low and moderate income communities, and other underserved communities and financial inclusion, for underserved communities. For example, we are seeking to advance financial inclusion through a number of reforms, including providing additional incentives for bank investments in minority depository institutions, or MDIs, and the geographic areas in need outside of assessment areas. Additionally, we are focused on updating standards in light of changes to banking over time, including mobile and internet banking, and several of the proposals are focused on updating these standards to reflect this change in banking. So we can turn to slide five. So hearing the concerns of a number of stakeholders, the second category of objectives include providing more certainty, tailoring, and minimizing burden. Specifically, this includes providing more certainty regarding what types of activities qualify and where those activities qualify. This also includes more transparency in how performance is evaluated and how ratings are assigned. Additionally, the board developed a proposed evaluation framework that can be tailored by bank size and business strategy and focused on minimizing additional burden. And as you can see in this slide, provide further clarification on CRA activities and LMI communities and recognize special circumstances of small banks, particularly in rural areas. Next slide, please, Carmen. Thanks. CRA reform has been a key priority for the Federal Reserve System, and the board has worked extensively with the FDIC and the OCC, which many of you know shares regulatory authority over CRA with the Federal Reserve. All banking agencies share similar goals on CRA modernization, and the board has benefited from extensive public feedback on CRA modernization approaches. The ANPR seeks to provide a foundation for the banking agencies to converge on a consistent regulatory approach that has a broad support among many stakeholders. Ultimately, the board is committed to getting CRA reform done right. Can we go to the next slide? So turning to assessment areas, the goal of our work was to modernize assessment areas to reflect changes in the banking industry, including internet and mobile banking, while maintaining a focus on branches. This was consistent with feedback we heard from both industry and community stakeholders. First, the ANPR asked for feedback on what's referred to as facility-based assessment areas, focusing on the bank's physical locations. The ANPR proposes keeping facility-based assessment areas around branches. The ANPR also proposes providing small banks with the flexibility to designate smaller assessment areas that are not a full county, while large banks could not have partial county assessment areas. The ANPR also asks for feedback on whether loan production offices should be a new basis for assessment areas and whether deposit-taking ATMs should continue to be a basis for assessment areas. Second, the ANPR asked for feedback on options for new assessment areas that would not be based on a bank's physical location. The ANPR also seeks feedback on new assessment areas based on concentration of either deposits or lending that is not near a branch. The ANPR also asked for feedback on establishing a nationwide assessment area for certain banks that have significant online activity. So let's move to the next slide. I'll be providing an overview of the evaluation framework in this slide, and then I'll turn it over to Matt. A key goal of the ANPR's proposed framework was to tailor evaluations to bank size and business model. Large retail banks would be evaluated under a retail test and a community development test. We think having two tests recognizes the importance of both retail and community development in meeting community needs. Small retail banks could continue to be evaluated under the current framework unless they choose to opt into the proposed framework. If a small bank elects the new framework, they would be assessed solely under the retail lending subtest unless they opt to have other activities considered as a possible enhancement to the retail's lending subtest rating. This is a place where the ANPR seeks feedback on where to draw the line on asset thresholds between small and large banks. Specifically, the ANPR proposes two options, a $750 million or $1 billion cutoff as the appropriate threshold. Wholesale and limited purpose banks would be evaluated under the community development test, much as they are under the current framework. And any bank could continue to be evaluated under a strategic plan. Now I'm going to turn it over to Matt to get into more detail on the evaluation frameworks.
Great, thanks, Andy. So this slide provides a graphic showing the evaluation framework for large banks, and I'll describe the two tests in a bit more detail. So under the retail test, there are two subtests, a retail lending subtest and a retail services subtest. The retail lending subtest would focus on how well a bank is lending in LMI communities and to LMI individuals, small businesses, and small farms. The board proposes a metrics-based approach for the retail lending subtest. The retail services subtest would focus on how well a bank's delivery systems and deposit products, for example, checking and savings accounts, serve LMI individuals and communities. This proposed retail services subtest also retains a focus on the importance of branches, while also proposing updates to respond to the way banking has changed with the rise of online banking. Retail services will continue to be evaluated qualitatively, though the board seeks feedback on the quantitative measures that could be incorporated. The community development test also includes two subtests, a community development financing subtest and a community development services subtest. The community development financing subtest would focus on measuring loans and investments towards affordable housing, economic development, community services, and revitalization and stabilization that benefit LMI individuals and communities. The community development services subtest would focus on volunteer activities that benefit LMI communities, as well as certain volunteer activities in rural areas. The ANPR proposes several options to help evaluate impact and responsiveness of community development activities, including the use of impact scores. Additionally, performance context would remain an important consideration. It's important to note when discussing our metrics-based approach, we are proposing an approach to develop performance standards that will reflect different economic conditions and opportunities in different parts of the country. Therefore, performance standards would be dynamic and calibrated to individual communities. Additionally, our approach uses metrics to evaluate assessment area performance and not performance for the institution overall. We'll discuss this a bit more when we talk about ratings shortly. Let's move to the next slide, please. The ANPR seeks to advance financial inclusion by proposing incentives for further bank investment in minority depository institutions, women-owned financial institutions, low-income credit unions, and community development financial institutions. For example, the ANPR proposes to make activities with MDIs as a factor to consider for an outstanding rating. Additionally, the ANPR proposes to automatically qualify activities with Treasury-certified CDFIs, with the goal of increasing capital to these mission-oriented institutions that also serve the credit needs of LMI communities, LMI individuals, and small businesses. In the area of CRA qualifying activities, we've heard feedback from stakeholders that there's a lack of clarity on what activities are eligible for CRA credit. To address this feedback, the ANPR proposes to better define eligibility for qualifying activities such as unsubsidized or naturally occurring affordable housing within the regulation. The ANPR also seeks feedback on designating certain community development activities as being responsive to community needs or particularly impactful, including affordable housing for very low-income households or economic development activity with the smallest businesses, smallest farms, and minority-owned small businesses. Lastly, there was positive stakeholder feedback on the OCC proposal to offer a pre-approval process for banks to get an advanced read on whether a particular activity would count, as well as to provide an illustrative list of qualifying activities. As a result, the ANPR seeks feedback on how such approaches could be designed and how they would work in practice. Let's move to the next slide, please. The ANPR proposes ways to add clarity on where banks can receive credit for community development activities. For example, the ANPR proposes that banks will receive consideration for activities outside their assessment areas, but anywhere within an eligible state, territory, or region where a bank has a facility-based assessment area. This would help address CRA hotspots and deserts, as banks might consider deploying resources more broadly to underserved areas outside of assessment areas if they were confident about CRA eligibility. Additionally, the ANPR asks for feedback on treatment of activities within designated areas of need, including Indian Country, the Delta, or other areas that exhibit persistent economic distress. Next slide, please. The board's proposed approach to developing ratings is grounded in performance in a bank's local communities. The proposal assigns ratings for the retail and community development tests based on conclusions at the assessment area level. The proposal also eliminates the distinction between full scope and limited scope assessment areas and seeks feedback on options to ensure that the ratings procedures are inclusive of all geographies, including smaller rural assessment areas. The board is examining approaches to more consistently evaluate community development activities outside assessment areas when assigning the state or institution rating for the community development test. Given CRA's emphasis on retail credit, the board believes that the retail test should be weighted slightly more than the community development test to determine overall institution ratings. Additionally, as discussed earlier, the board is proposing to make activities with MDIs, women-owned financial institutions, and low-income credit unions considered for an outstanding rating. Finally, the ANPR proposes retaining the practice that if examiners determine that a bank has engaged in discriminatory or illegal credit practices, including violations of relevant consumer laws and regulations enacted or implemented since Regulation BB was last substantially updated, a ratings downgrade could occur at the institution level. Next slide, please. With respect to minimizing data collection and reporting burden, the ANPR recognizes the potential trade-off between additional data collection and reporting requirements on the one hand and greater use of metrics to attain certainty on the other. It seeks feedback on the best way to balance these important objectives. The proposed metrics would rely to the greatest extent possible on existing data. Small banks would be exempt from deposit data collection and reporting requirements, and data used for the lending analysis would be the same as is used for current examinations. Existing data sources would also be used when possible for large banks. New data collection and reporting on community development financing activities would be required to evaluate community development financing in a transparent and consistent manner. The ANPR also seeks feedback on deposit data options for large banks, and in particular for large banks with extensive deposit activity outside of the areas served by their physical branches. Specifically, the board is evaluating the use of FDIC summary of deposits data versus new data collection and reporting. Next slide, please. The board received significant feedback on addressing rural areas for banks and community groups and has made a conscious effort to encourage banks' activities in rural areas and to recognize the unique needs and opportunities in these areas. Rural areas often have less community development capacity and opportunity, so we think it's important for banks to give back to their local communities in different ways. The ANPR proposes to consider a wider range of community development service activities in rural areas, such as volunteering to help build affordable housing and serving on the board of impactful civic or nonprofit organizations. Second, as discussed earlier, the ANPR proposes to designate geographic areas of need where banks could conduct activities outside of assessment areas. The board believes this could help encourage more activities in rural areas where there are unmet credit needs. Third, the proposal includes the use of calibrated thresholds for both the retail lending and community development financing subtests, so performance standards better reflect the differing needs and opportunities in rural areas. Finally, the proposal includes several options to ensure that all assessment areas, including smaller rural assessment areas, are factored into a bank's overall ratings. Carmen, I'll pass it to you.
Thank you, Matt. All stakeholders have expressed strong support for the agencies to work together to modernize CRA. By reflecting stakeholder views and providing appropriately long periods of 120 days for public comment, the ANPR advances the goal of building a foundation for the banking agencies to converge on a consistent approach that has the broad support of stakeholders. The Federal Reserve will continue our ongoing analysis of issues included in the ANPR and will seek the views of stakeholders, including the other banking agencies, throughout this process. We encourage you to review the ANPR and all of the additional supporting documents on the board's public rulemaking page and submit a comment through the formal channel, as noted here. We also anticipate organizing additional outreach opportunities within our district and look forward to hearing your comments. At this time, we will begin the Q&A process, and we received a few questions ahead of time and want to be certain that we incorporate those comments and questions. So the first question came to us and is related to community development. And the question specifically was asking whether community development will be at the forefront of any CRA regulation. And I will ask Andy to answer that, or Matt.
Andy, I can take this. So yes, definitely. Community development is sort of at the forefront of a lot of these proposals. You know, not only are there proposed changes for expanding the qualification of community development activities outside of bank's assessment area, but also there's, you know, a pretty substantial change in the methodology for analyzing community development activities under the community development test for large banks. You know, in addition, there's proposals for expanding upon and clarifying activities that qualify as affordable housing, community services, economic development, and revitalization and stabilization. And then there are also the proposals to create the non-exhaustive illustrative list of qualified community development activities, as well as establishing a pre-approval process to better improve the certainty about the qualification of CD activities.
Thank you, Matt. Brian, I know that there's another question that came through. Would you like to ask that, please?
Sure. Carmen, I just want to make sure you can hear me. This is my first time speaking.
Yes, I can hear you.
So we had a question about the fact that there's an OCC rule and now an ANPR from the Federal Reserve. And I just wanted to talk a little bit about that. One thing I wanted to start with is that we aren't really allowed to comment on interagency dynamics, but I did want to say that it is still our belief that there's an opportunity for a joint interagency rule, and the point of having these stakeholder feedback meetings is that we're committed to converging on a consistent approach with the other agencies, and that's the goal in putting out the ANPR. Our proposal reflects a broad set of stakeholder views, including the ideas advanced by the OCC and the FDIC. The ANPR seeks to build a foundation for the agencies to ultimately develop a consistent approach that has broad support. It also provides for a long period of comment in the hopes of building a foundation for the agencies to ultimately work together on a consistent approach that is a result of that broad support and your feedback. We know that the stakeholders, that you all have expressed a strong support for the agencies to work together to modernize CRA under one rule, and the proposal builds a foundation for the agencies to develop a shared modernized CRA framework with that support. So that's the answer.
Great. Andy, did you have anything else to add?
No, Brian really covered it. You know, I mean, I think just to really emphasize, Governor Brandon pretty much stated it, you know, when the ANPR was released in her speech that, you know, there's a long carmen period here, and that was intentional, and that the ANPR is really intended to build that foundation for the banking agencies to try to converge on a consistent approach that has a broad support among all stakeholders. So Brian said it well.
Great. There was another question that came in. How can CRA incentivize Compliance Plus to propel work toward closing the racial wealth gap and mitigate new differing regulations, risking a backslide to the reason CRA came into being in the first place? And maybe, Matt, I'll have you address this, please.
Yeah, sure. So the presentation today, both Andy and mine's sections, you know, it didn't address financial inclusion. And it's something that when the ANPR came out, we thought was something that was front and center, you know, more so, this, you know, than the current regulation. But just specific to the presentation, it does talk about CRA's role in advancing financial inclusion, and the examples were given by proposing incentives for further bank investment in MDIs, women-owned financial institutions, low-income credit unions and CDFIs, as well as activities benefiting, you know, these types of entities being considered as a potential pathway to an outstanding rating. And on September 21st, which was the day that ANPR was announced, Governor Brainerd addressed this topic in a speech, so I have a few bullets here just to give a high-level summary of, you know, this topic from that speech. So within there, she stated that CRA is a seminal statute that remains as important as ever as the nation confronts challenges associated with racial equity and the COVID-19 pandemic. It must be ensured that the CRA is a strong and effective tool to address ongoing systemic inequities and access to credit and financial services for LMI and minority individuals and communities. Given the disproportionate impact of COVID-19 on communities of color, it is important to support the institutions that have a mission to serve the families, entrepreneurs, and homeowners in these communities. The ANPR raises a variety of additional ideas that could be significant for financial inclusion. It proposes giving banks greater certainty that their community development activities will be considered in broader statewide and regional areas, in addition to activities within their local communities, so banks could help address needs in credit deserts if they have the capacity to do so. And in considering economic development, the ANPR considers that loans to the smallest businesses, smallest farms, and minority-owned small businesses might be considered impactful and responsive to community needs. And in addition, the ANPR proposes elevating the focus on the availability of checking and savings accounts in serving LMI communities. And finally, in considering how CRA's purpose and history relate to the nation's current challenges, the board seeks feedback on what other modifications and approaches would strengthen the CRA regulation in addressing systemic inequities and credit access for minority individuals and communities.
Thank you, Matt. At this time, I am going to just stop and ask my panelists, Andy, Matt, Brian, Praval, if there is anything else. Those were the questions that we've received thus far, and we invite you to email us and send us additional questions that you may have, and we'll look forward to speaking with you again during the phase two process and other roundtable conversations that we will have a chance to have. So Andy, Matt, Praval, or Brian, any additional comments?
This Praval, comment is if you do click on the links in the Federal Register, one of the things that is done that I think is actually very helpful is there are specific questions that are outlined in the register, and there's a lot of them. But you are able to search on the sections that are maybe most relevant to what you're interested in, whether that's small business or community development and housing, and by looking at that section, you can then focus in on the specific questions that are being asked. And I think those give you a really good insight into where your comments are going to be most impactful. So just want to highlight, there are a lot of them, but if you look by section and then you focus in on the questions that are there, I think that'll help as you structure your comments, if you're able to make them. And again, we're so appreciative. We know that that's work and effort for you to do. And I think the speakers here have made a really good case for why it's so important.
Yeah, this is Andy. So I think Prabal made a good point there. So, I think that there are 99 questions throughout the ANPR. And I think if you look at the structure, at first glance, it doesn't seem perhaps maybe a lot different than the lending service and community development test that we have now, lending service and investment test. But, there are a lot of nuances, and there is some pretty significant attempts here to really kind of address some of the changes that have occurred in both the industry and the way financial services are provided. There may be something in particular that you want to focus on. So, is it the assessment area? Is it, consideration of certain activities, more clarity on that? Is it, the metrics piece, does that make sense? Does it ring true? So, even if there's one or two things that really kind of stand out and you're passionate about or you have an opinion about, that will definitely help us as we go through this process. So, again, even if you don't have the time to go through the entire proposal, and it is long, if there is one or two points that you're particularly interested in, any feedback would really be appreciated by the Federal Reserve System and the folks down on the board that are continuing to craft what we hope to be a really solid rule that will take us hopefully through the next generation.
Yeah, this is Matt. I want to echo what Prabal and Andy just touched upon. I agree with everything they said there. I would encourage everybody to take a look at this, especially if you're a financial institution, just to get a sense of, the proposals in there, how would they impact how your institution could be evaluated. And as I think Carmen was saying at the beginning, this is sort of the initial outreach to give a high-level summary of what's in the ANPR. There are sort of important details in the ANPR that were not mentioned here today that, from an institution perspective might be of great interest, either positive or negative. So, one thing that comes to mind is there's discussion about a potential online dashboard. So you could see how your bank is performing in real time against proposed thresholds. That's something that might be a little bit touched upon a little bit more in depth within the next phase of outreach. But I would just encourage institutions to take a look at that because, we didn't cover some of the more nuanced issues here today. And again, I encourage everybody to read it and comment. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Anything else, Brian, from you?
No, I did have someone text me and ask if these slides would be made available. So I don't know. I don't know the answer to that. So I just know that there's going to be some demand for seeing this information afterwards.
Yes. Great question, Brian. We will have the presentation and the recording available on the website.
Great.
So, ladies and gentlemen, this concludes today's event. I want to thank you for taking the time to attend today. You may now disconnect your lines and have a great day.
Thank you.